for the warm hospitality and excellent arrangements of this meeting. My delegation also wishes to strongly endorse 1.7 billion people, a collective economy of $19 trillion, and the destination and source of $2.2 trillion trade, to present the case of the defenseless and vulnerable Muslims of Indian occupied Kashmir. It has now been almost 7 decades that India had been trying to crush the genuine indigenous movement of Kashmiris from the right to self-determination with complete impunity. The Kashmiri Muslims have paid a huge price for their struggle. Over the years, Indian occupation forces have martyred more than 100,000 Kashmiris. Some 130,000 have been arrested and are languishing in Indian jails. Over 20,000 Kashmiri men are missing with their fate unknown. There is an estimated figure of 107,000 children orphaned, 23,000 women widowed, around 11,000 dishonored in mass rapes, and tens of thousands severely injured people as a result of continued torture. There is a systematic effort by India to bring about demographic change in the Indian occupied Kashmir. Already the total percentage of Muslim population has reportedly gone down from 79% in 1947 to 68% as of now. Honorable Chair, Indian efforts to equate Kashmiri Muslim self-determination movement with terrorism have been rejected by the OIC countries, for which we deeply appreciate the leadership of all OIC members and by large international community has also not subscribed to Indian notion. As a matter of fact, it is India which has unleashed worst state terrorism against unarmed Kashmiri Muslims. It is manifested in the numerous draconian laws enacted over the years to give timeless, limitless powers and immunity to occupational forces from legal accountability. This includes the Armed Forces Special Power Act 1990, Prevention of Terrorism Act 2002, the Terrorist and Disruptive Activities 1990, GNK Public Safety Act 1998, and the list goes on. Let me also invite your attention to the fact that in 2009, Kashmiri human rights activists and lawyer Parvez Imroz and Parvez Khurram and their friends discovered around 3,000 unnamed mass graves in three districts of Indian occupied Kashmir, with each grave having multiple corpses. This shocking disclosure was further authenticated by a preliminary but comprehensive 112-page report entitled Buried Evidence, which was published by the Indian occupied based NGO, the International People's Tribunal. It exposes Indian occupation forces atrocities, and India blatantly lies about line of control infiltration and fake encounters in which they had been killing indigenous Kashmiris by calling them foreign infiltrators. I strongly urge on the Secretary General of PUIC to issue a demand for an independent probe into this genocide, led by independent permanent Human Rights Commission or jointly the UNHRC Geneva. I have provided a DVD on mass graves which was produced by the United Kingdom's Channel 4 TV, and the report I mentioned. In the light of these documentary proofs, the IPHRC team may meet the members of the Association of the Parents of the Disappeared to further collaborate the facts. Distinguished brothers and sisters, the recent spate of terror unleashed by the Indian forces in a wake of extrajudicial killing of teenager Kashmiri social media icon and leader of self-determination movement, Burhan Muzaffarwani, on 8th July 2016, merit the immediate notice by the international community. The gravity of the situation and intensity of the Indian occupation forces, worst ever atrocities in human history, could be visible from the facts that some of the short presentation that I have brought with me. A brief slideshow will show you all as to how the children have been butchered and blinded by the use of pellet guns. Please spare a few minutes to see the Indian brutalities against Kashmiri Muslims.
Whose next generation will be blind. Come, let's visit Kashmir. This is the future generation of Kashmir, laying on hospital beds, blinded. A weapon called pellet gun is blinding the people of Kashmir, mostly teens and children. Young teens have lost their hopes. They see no future now. Who were these rebels and who did this to them? Is demanding freedom a crime? Every victim thinks. They too had seen dreams, but now their life is dark. The pellets have pierced their eyes, leaving them in despair. Not able to see the world, they are suffering mental agony and pain. With their families shattered, hopes lost, and wet eyes. They're scared to face the world because the oppressors may catch them. The children have lost their childhood, their fantasies. Their mothers are wailing, sitting beside them in hospital beds. These blooming buds will unfortunately have to live a life of misery. The dwellers of heaven are bearing the pain that of hell. But Almighty, no one can suppress these rebellions. Every second hour, pellets rupture and eye hear. More than 664 people are hit in the eyes since the uprising and are still counting. This is the heaven Kashmir yelling out to the world. When cruelty makes flow blood streams, O people, thou shalt witness and tell. It can withstand even an ocean of screams when heaven is turned into a living hell.
Distinguished colleagues, it is unfortunate that in the face of such grave violations of human rights of Kashmir Muslims, none of the proponents and standard bearers of human right protection, be it international forum or states, particularly the Western world, have condemned India. But OIC as a forum, OIC Contact Group on Kashmir, IPHRC, and the Secretary General of OIC not only strongly condemned India, but also effectively raised voice for the Kashmir rights and called upon India for immediate halt to the Kashmiri bloodshed. UNHR Commissioner also recognized grievous situation and called for sending a fact-finding mission to the Indian occupied Kashmir in the address to the 33rd session of the UNHRC in Geneva last month. Amnesty International office in India was shut down when they expressed their concern over the grave situation in the Indian-occupied Kashmir. some of the members of civil society across Europe, North America, Nordic region have protested and taken out rallies, literal activities to support of Kashmir. They have been joined by the diaspora of Kashmiris and Pakistanis, as well as members of the parliament in those regions. While India remains defiant, the world attention on HR violations has brought immense pressure on India. Even from within India, there have been severe reaction on the genocide of Kashmiri Muslims at the hands of Indian occupied forces. Let me quote just one example which promptly reflects what India is doing to the Kashmiris, and some of the Indians have reacted. Tariq Hamid Karar, a lawmaker from Srinagar, formally resigned from parliament in protest, stating, "The prevailing situation in Kashmir is not only alarming, but tragic as well. Every single day, the number of injured is outnumbering the hospital capacity, and the number of arrested is outnumbering the lockups. For the first time in the history of Jammu and Kashmir, people of Kashmir are forced not to offer Eid prayers. The present situation can't be allowed to deter anymore, or it could have dangerous consequences for the state and the region. I also wish to inform members of the executive committee that since 8th July, Kashmiris have not been allowed to offer Juma prayers, which confirms prosecution of Muslims in Indian occupied Kashmir and exposes Indian false claims of being a democratic or a secular country. India is desperately trying to deflect the international community's focus on Indian-occupied Kashmir. The Baloch card would actually further expose Indian involvement in destabilizing activities in Pakistan, heating up of line of control with war rhetoric, sabotaging of SAARC summit in Pakistan and Uri attack, timing of which could only suit India, are some of the manifestations of Indian desperation. Indian warmongering will endanger not just the South Asian region, but also the world at large. Therefore, in the greater interest of peace and stability, India should stop from heightening tension. Up till now, Pakistan has shown restraint, but any aggression from India will meet with full force. My nation is ready to protect Pakistan's sovereignty and territorial integrity at all costs. The entire responsibility will be on India for any eventualities. The international community should focus on Indian belligerence and not Pakistan. It's India that needs counseling. Concluding my speech, Pakistan proposes inclusion of Kashmir dispute on the agenda of the 5th meeting of the Standing Specialized Committee on Political Affairs to discuss implementation of long-standing UN Security Council resolution on Kashmir. To address the grave human rights situation in Indian-occupied Kashmir, Pakistan proposes inclusion of HR violations in Indian-occupied Kashmir by India on the agenda of Committee of Human Rights, Women and Family. A draft of the resolution in this regard has already been submitted by my delegation. My country also hopes that the August gathering will show solidarity with the Muslims of Kashmir by focusing on their plight in Ankara Declaration. And I finally wish to suggest considering establishment of a special committee or a OIC parliamentary friendship group on Kashmir. I thank you all for your consistent support. Thank you.
Teşekkür ediyorum Sayın Başkan.